Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Okay. All right, so we'll get started with a news vendor problem. A very simple two-stage stochastic program. So Warren Buffett, who's the one of the richest person on the planet, was a news vendor at one point of time. So that's my motivation for teaching you news vendors problem. The idea is as follows. A news vendor would pick up certain number of newspapers in the morning, and depending upon how many customers arrive at the newsstand, he or she is going to sell certain number of newspapers, and there'll be a leftover set of newspapers, or there may be no leftovers depending upon how many customers arrive. And in the end of the day, whatever newspapers are left, it needs to be sold back to the newspaper agency. So the problem is as follows. So C is the cost of newspaper. P is the price of newspaper. R is the return price. X is the number of newspapers bought. Y of omega. Omega is the number of customers, so number of customers arriving at the newsstand. And Y of omega is number of newspapers sold. And Z of omega is number of newspapers returned. So a lot of notation. And we are going to make the following assumption. R is less than C is less than P. So that's one. And omega has probability distribution function F of omega. So probability of an event A is integral A F of omega d omega. I'm going to define another notation. It's called cumulative distribution function F of X is used, Y is used, Z is used. F of A is equal to integral 0 to A F of omega d omega. Okay, and the thing here is we can remove newspaper and we can put any perishable item in this framework. Okay, so whether it's food, whether it's a restaurant, so a restaurant has to order a certain amount of food in the morning, it charges certain price to their customers, And of course, in the case of restaurant, they cannot really return the leftover food, so they have to throw it away. I think that's the rule all over the world. So for safety reasons, the food has to be thrown away. So R is actually zero in the case of a restaurant. X is the, and so of course everyone, all the restaurant owners also have to decide how much of lettuce and how much of bread and how much of other things needs to be bought in order to serve the customers during the day. Okay, so newspaper is not the only thing here. The important thing is that the item has to perish by the end of the day or by the end of a time period. That's the key idea. Okay, what should the optimization problem be? Can someone help with the optimization formulation? What should I minimize? Minimize expectation of what? Profit. So what should the profit be? Negative of profit, right? So what's negative of profit? P minus C into Y of omega. And what else? R minus C of W of omega. And then there is also C multiplied by X. Let me do it the way Stu was talking about. So P multiplied by Y of omega, R multiplied by Z of omega, and then CX, which is the cost of buying X newspapers. And what should the constraints be? So what's the fundamental constraints of newspapers? Y of omega plus Z of omega less than equal to X. Y of omega, Z of omega, and X greater than equal to zero. Okay, so this is the news vendor's problem. Those of you who will go for MBA, the smarter lot in this class, this is one of the first problems you will study in an optimization class in B school. How do I go about solving this problem? Any thoughts? So let's split it into two stages. So this is a two-stage problem, because in stage one, you buy the newspapers. In stage two, you sell the newspapers and return whatever is left over. So we can apply dynamic programming in this problem because it's a two-stage problem. So what would the last stage two optimization problem be? Any guesses? What's the optimization happening at the second stage? Sorry? Returning, returning as well as selling, both of them happens at the last stage. So the stage two problem is, Z of omega is less than equal to X. I think there has to be another constraint. Y of omega is less than equal to omega. We cannot sell more newspapers than the number of customers who arrive. Okay. And this optimization, this minimum, is over y of omega and z of omega greater than equal to 0. And I'm going to store the minimum value as a function of both x comma omega. So x appears in the constraint. Omega is, of course, it also appears in the constraint. And all the variables are dependent on omega. Yes?
You said stage one was just buying the newspapers, right?
Yes. Okay. So in this case, the optimization is being performed over three variables, y, z, and x. So when I have to split the problem into two-stage problem, I collect all the terms with omega in one optimization routine. And then I minimize with respect to all the variables that include omega. What would the solution to this be? So let's write down what y star of omega would be. Okay, so let's argue this out. So p is positive. Oh, I haven't written p is positive, so. P is positive, R is positive. So it's in my best interest to sell as many newspapers as I have or as many newspapers as the customers arrive. So Y star of omega is min of X comma omega, and Z star of omega is max of 0 comma omega minus X. So one can arrive at this optimal solution by inspection in this problem, or if you want to be more sophisticated, you can use Lagrange multiplier to arrive at this solution. Any questions so far? So I have a two-stage problem which involves some amount of uncertainty. I split the problem into two stages. So using dynamic programming, I have to solve the final stage problem first, collect all the terms with omega, formulate an optimization problem. So the only constraint that is not in that optimization problem is this constraint, x greater than or equal to 0, because that doesn't depend on omega. Rest all the constraints are here. And I solve this problem, and I get y star of omega, which means sell the minimum of the number of newspapers you have or the number of people who come to your newsstand, and return all the remaining newspapers if you have any. Okay. So if you have more customers than the number of newspapers, you will sell omega minus x. If you have more newspapers, less customers, you will return zero newspapers. No, did I make a mistake? I think it should be x minus omega. Let me think. Oh, yeah. It should be x minus omega. So if I have more customers, if I have more newspapers, less customers, then I'll return x minus omega number of newspapers at the second stage, or I will return zero newspapers. I'll sell all the newspapers. Okay, now this is correct. Now what should we do at the stage one? ideally, in stage one, I want to minimize my total cost, so that's C multiplied by X plus the future cost, okay? But the future cost is dependent on some uncertain parameter, so I can't really do minimize the cost over X because X would then depend on omega, but I don't know what omega is. So we will do what some of your friends suggested in the previous class, take the average. Okay, so I know that over between 10 to 20 customers arrive. For each number of customers, this is the optimal cost. Let's take the average over all optimal costs. And I'm going to minimize it over X greater than or equal to 0. That's the only constraint that doesn't depend on omega. Questions? Question? No? Yes. This is R. This is R, and this is also R. No gamma here. Yeah. Okay. So we solved the second stage problem. Now we need to compute the expectation. So this is the expectation of future cost that I'm going to see. So we are going to spend some time just computing this expectation. Okay, this expectation is a non-trivial quantity. So let's try and figure out what the expectation is equal to. By the way, football tickets are also perishable items. Once the football game is over, the ticket has no value. Okay, so news vendor's problem is important even there. Okay, so it's minus P integral of this is over 0 to infinity, and then minus R integral 0 to infinity . Is anyone in the class into the business of buying and selling football tickets? No one? Okay. Don't you get discounted tickets? I heard that students get some discounted tickets and then you can sell it off in a secondary market at a much higher price.
I don't know if that's legal. Is that legal?
I think it's legal.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. All right, so I guess you never knew you have to solve complicated problems to sell football tickets, but unfortunately, that's what you have to do. Okay, we need to evaluate this integral. Any thoughts on how to evaluate it? Oh, okay. So he's, Jian Zhuang is saying, I can split this integral from 0 to x and x to infinity. Let's do that. What's min of x comma omega between 0 to x? Omega. F of omega d omega, then minus p integral x to infinity, what's min of x comma omega from x to infinity, so that's omega. Oh, that's x. Let's do the same thing here, minus r integral 0 to x. This is x minus omega. Okay, this term is 0, so I can forget it. I'm only left with 3 terms. But I have integral of x omega twice. So r multiplied by x and then p multiplied by x. I'm not sure if we have made any mistake there. Let me check. Oh, I see. Okay. Okay, cool. Okay, so this is cool. I have integral omega f omega, so that's a complicated integral. This is easy because x is actually a constant in the entire domain of omega goes from x to infinity. So this is a constant, so I can pull it out of the integral. In this case, I can pull x out of the integral, but of course, again, I have omega, integral 0 to x omega f omega d omega. So collecting all the terms, I have minus p minus r integral 0 to x omega f omega d omega minus p x 1 minus f x minus r r x f x. Okay, so this is an identity. So integral x to infinity of f omega d omega is equal to 1 minus fx. Okay. So at first glance, this expression looks very complicated, but actually there is a simplification waiting for us, and that's as follows. I can write integral omega f omega d omega as integral f prime omega d omega. Anyone remember the integration by parts formula? I don't, but if anyone can. Come on, guys, this is a graduate class. Oh, yeah, I remember, okay. This is omega f omega, so omega integral of this function minus integral f omega and derivative of omega and then d omega. Okay. Okay, so that's good. This is integration by parts. So I now can take the limit 0 to x omega f omega d omega is equal to x fx minus integral 0 to x f omega d omega. Okay. I did the most complicated part of the class. So now everything is just plain substitution. So I have let's do it. P minus R X FX minus or plus P minus R integral 0 to X F omega D omega minus PX minus PX FX, no, plus PX FX minus RX FX. I think I have noted everything correctly. Are there any cancellations here? Okay. Yes, so this term cancels with this term. Oh, now things look pretty simple. So it's minus px plus p minus r integral 0 to x f omega d omega. Okay, so this is my expected cost of the second stage. This is my value function. Is the derivation clear so far? So this is equivalent to, I want to minimize x greater than 0, cx minus px plus P minus R so this is C minus P X. So I have a linear function of X plus a function of x which appears in the integral. Is this a convex function? So a linear function is convex for sure. This is positive because p minus r is positive by definition. Is this a convex function of x? So let's check if this is convex function of x or not. So integral 0 to x f omega d omega, what's the first derivative with respect to x? Capital F of x. This is only true when f is continuous, but f is continuous because we have a distribution function. So this is true. What about second derivative of integral 0 to x f omega d omega. This is small f of x, and I know that this is non-negative. So this is convex function. This is a convex function. So this is a convex cost, and I want to minimize over all x greater than or equal to 0. What should I do? But this is a constrained optimization. You are going in the same direction, but I want you to argue it out. So this is a constrained optimization. So Jianzong's idea is take the first derivative, okay? And my point is this is a constrained optimization, so why should I take the first derivative? So can someone argue it out that why taking the first derivative is the right thing to do? Yeah.
It's not at the boundary, then that would be sufficient.
Yeah, if it is in the constraint set, then that would be sufficient. So let's take the first derivative, find what the value of x star looks like. If that x star is positive, then we are good. Then we don't have to worry about the constraint. Let's do it. So first derivative c minus p plus p minus r capital Fx bar. So first derivative at x bar. I'm going to set it equal to 0. This implies x bar equals to f inverse p minus c over p minus r. So my f function, so this is my f, cumulative distribution function, it looks something like this. It sort of saturates at 1. And I had the assumption that r is less than c is less than p. So this implies that p minus c is less than p minus r. Or in other words, p minus c over p minus r is less than 1. So x bar is inverse of the f at this point. This is so this is where this is what the optimal solution would be. So x bar is positive in this case. X bar is positive, and therefore, that's the optimal solution. Yes.
Don't we only expect like an integer number of people to show up?
Yes, but so this is a solving for an integer would be very difficult. So this is an approximation to that particular problem. And it gives you a reasonable result. Now you can pick any integer around this number. which is what you would actually buy. So if you are a first-time news vendor, or if you just opened a restaurant, how would you figure out how much to buy? You opened a hip sandwich shop, and you don't quite know what the distribution of customers is going to be. How would you pick how many sandwiches you need to prepare in the morning so that you can earn as much money as possible, get the maximum expected profit? You have some thoughts?
So we have the distribution. This
requires knowing the distribution, right? But if you have opened a new shop, you don't know what the distribution is.
So do we estimate it or start estimating the distribution?
Yeah, so you basically estimate the distribution. You run your shop at a loss for the first few days, perhaps at a loss, we don't know, right? And then you get the distribution. And once you get the distribution, you can figure out how many things to buy in the morning. So for instance, Kroger, long time back, wasn't selling sandwiches. It was selling bread and it was selling vegetables, and you could make sandwich at home. But now Kroger has started selling cut vegetables, cut fruits, cut this, cut that, even cut sandwiches. So initially they don't know how many sandwiches to make. And then slowly over a period of time, over a period of 1 year, they kind of collect the data. And then they figure out how many sandwiches to make every day in the morning. There's another important part, which is something that I have not mentioned. It was in one of the homeworks earlier, but now it's not there in this particular class. So I gave a homework where I gave a two-state stochastic program for a store where the revenues are different. So the P was completely different for two stores. So you can think of Subway, where you get $5 sandwiches. And you could think about an expensive restaurant where you get $20 sandwiches with the same ingredients. And the question I was asking was, how many sandwiches should the restaurant make versus how many sandwiches should the Subway person make? And it turned out that the Subway person will make the minimum number of sandwiches that is going to be sold during the entire day, whereas an expensive restaurant owner will make maximum number of sandwiches that it can sell during the entire day. And that's because that's the profit maximizing point. So just because, so the profit maximizing points would depend strongly on what the revenue is from each selling and what the cost is of making a sandwich. So different stores will have different preferences about what the optimal solution is based on their own calculation. Okay, and that's basically coming out of the stochastic program. Okay, it's not out of a deterministic program because you don't know how many customers are going to come and buy. But if you solve the stochastic program problem, it tells you how many sandwiches you should make, how many newspapers you should buy, and things like that. You know, all the markets for perishable goods. Any questions? Yes.
What do you call it? Is it a continuous approximation from what you were saying earlier?
Yeah.
What do you call that?
There is no specific name to it. It's just an approximation.
Okay.
But there are a lot of continuous approximations to discrete things, discrete events. So in the case of queuing theory, it is known as fluid limit. In the case of game theory, it is called mean field games. So you basically approximate finite number of players with infinite number of players. So that's the mean field limit. So different theories will have different name to it. But in this case, it's just an approximation. It doesn't have a specific name. Any other question? Okay, so that's all I have for today. In the next class, I'm going to talk about Markov decision problems. Any other specific topic that you guys want to study? on optimization. So I've done neural network backpropagation algorithm in assignment. I have done news vendors problem, which will make you rich. And either by selling tickets or by making sandwiches, I don't know which one you would prefer. Okay. But any other topic that is of interest to people? Genetic algorithms. Okay, I'll do it on Wednesday. Or how many people want to study genetic algorithms? Sorry? Game theory? Oh. I can give another 40 lectures on game theory. Yes. So that's part of rollout algorithm. Model predictive control is an instance of a rollout algorithm. So I already talked about rollout.
Can we cover some discrete optimization
techniques? Which means integer programming kind of stuff? Okay, I'll think about it. So I have discrete optimization, I have game theory, I have genetic algorithms. What else? Okay, I'll probably do game theory because that's closer to my subject. So I'll just do game theory in the final class. All right, thank you guys.